Roosevelt and the United Nations by Sanderson Beck. Truly, if the genius of mankind that has invented the weapons of death cannot discover the means of preserving peace, civilization as we know it lives in an evil day. Franklin Roosevelt. Peace comes from the spirit and must be grounded in faith. Franklin Roosevelt. Freedom means the supremacy of human rights everywhere. Franklin Roosevelt. Roosevelt and the United Nations Alliance. As with Woodrow Wilson and the League of Nations, the primary initiator of the United Nations was an American president, Franklin Roosevelt. However, Roosevelt, the United States, and the world had learned from failures with the League. Roosevelt was not as closely identified with the United Nations as Wilson had been with the League, and he died shortly before the United Nations founding conference and the termination of the Second World War. Franklin Delano Roosevelt was born on January 30, 1882, at Hyde Park, New York. At Harvard, young Franklin was not particularly studious, but he excelled in extracurricular activities. He admired the progressive policies of President Theodore Roosevelt, who was his distant cousin, and he married T.R.'s niece, Eleanor Roosevelt. Eleanor was his lifelong partner in political work, and after his death, she was a leading promoter of the United Nations. Franklin became a lawyer and was elected state senator in 1910 as a progressive Democrat. Roosevelt supported Woodrow Wilson for president, and he was appointed Assistant Secretary of the Navy in 1913. In July 1919, when the League of Nations was being debated, Roosevelt argued that the League was necessary for a successful peace settlement. He concluded hopefully, "If the League of Nations, with its future benefits to the world, is adopted, the future generations will look to us and call us blessed." In 1920, FDR was selected by the Democratic Convention as their candidate for vice president and running mate of James Cox. Roosevelt campaigned in favor of the League of Nations, saying that for the first time in history, nations were being placed on the same basis as the relations between individuals. He asked, "Why should one outlaw nation be able to run amok and murder or maim a brother nation without being called to account for it, without being prevented from further misdeeds in the community of nations?" Roosevelt believed that the United States loves peace but loves honor more, and so threw its nation into the war. Then he prophetically warned his country, "If you want the repetition of another war against civilization, then let us go back to the conditions of 1914. If you want the possibility of sending once more our troops and navies to foreign lands, then stay out of the League." In a speech on September 24, 1920, candidate Roosevelt explained how Republican Party leaders decided to sabotage the League in order to prevent a Republican defeat in the presidential election, even after President Wilson had met with Republican leaders and gotten the Monroe Doctrine incorporated into the League covenant. FDR described how Will Hayes, chairman of the Republican National Committee, secretly met with Senators Lodge, Borah, Brandegee, and others and convinced them to follow a deliberate and carefully planned campaign to throw over the Treaty of Peace and to discredit the President of the United States in order to secure a victory for the Republican Party. The choice was made at that time. Partisan advantage was placed first, and the restoration of peace to civilization was thrown into the discard. As a result of that determination of more than 1 year ago, the restoration of peace still hangs in the balance. This is recognized not only here, but throughout the world. In the closing days of the campaign, Roosevelt raised the moral question of the League versus the banking interest, He pointed out how educators, religious leaders, lawyers, organizations of mothers, and soldiers who fought in France favored the League because they were aware of the issues. He warned voters, those who are not up on the League, who have not read it, who do not comprehend it in an intelligent sense, will cast the majority of the votes in favor of the Republican nominees for president and vice president. Lined up with them are most of the financiers and moneyed interests. Also, about 80% of the newspapers of the United States. The Republicans won the election. Suddenly, in August 1921, Franklin Roosevelt was struck with polio and was almost completely paralyzed. He regained the use of everything except his legs, but he remained physically crippled in the legs for the rest of his life. However, he refused to retire, as his mother suggested, and he stayed active in politics with Eleanor's help. In 1924, he proposed a new international organization to replace the League, and at the Democratic Convention, he nominated his fellow New Yorker, Governor Al Smith, for president. Smith urged him to run for governor in 1928, and Roosevelt was elected and re-elected in 1930. In 1932, Roosevelt wrestled the presidential nomination away from Smith and won a big victory over Hoover during the depth of the Depression. As president, Roosevelt took immediate action to meet the crisis with his various New Deal programs of recovery for a blighted economy. He was overwhelmingly re-elected in 1936, but he had difficulty with the Supreme Court and the recession in 1937. Roosevelt had brought a creative and dynamic activity to government to deal with massive economic problems based on his real concern for the poor, the unemployed, and the destitute. His programs attempted to establish economic and social security for all Americans. His first major foreign policy speech was on Woodrow Wilson's birthday at the end of 1933. He clearly defined United States policy as being opposed to armed intervention. In an unusual statement for a politician, he admitted, "The blame for the danger to world peace lies not in the world population, but in the political leaders." He recalled how the masses of people had enthusiastically responded to Wilson's gallant appeal and how political profit, personal prestige, and national aggrandizement had handicapped the League's inception. Roosevelt believed that the old policies, alliances, combinations, and balances of power have proved themselves inadequate for the preservation of world peace. The League of Nations, encouraging as it does the extension of non-aggression pacts, a reduction of armament agreements, is a prop in the world peace structure. Perhaps the same is true of the United Nations today, and the same challenge that Wilson and Roosevelt faced we still face today, which is, as FDR stated, whether people themselves could not someday prevent governments from making war. Although it was politically impossible for the American president to get the United States involved in the League, Roosevelt did encourage cooperation with the non-political and humanitarian work of League agencies. In his quarantine speech on October 5, 1937, Roosevelt spoke out against the worsening world situation caused by violations of treaties and undeclared acts of war that killed innocent civilians. He warned that America would not be safe from the contagion of war. He asserted that peace-loving nations must attempt to uphold laws and treaties because in international anarchy there is no escape through isolation. Those who cherish their freedom and recognize and respect the equal right of their neighbors to be free and live in peace must work together for the triumph of law and moral principles in order that peace, justice, and confidence may prevail in the world. He pointed out how much of the world's economy was being spent on armaments. The president believed that America must actively engage in the search for peace, and he suggested a quarantine against the epidemic of aggressor nations. Thus, the policy of the United States was no longer isolation, and shortly a lead committee declared that Japan was the aggressor against China. A year later, Roosevelt pleaded with Hitler to settle the differences between Germany and Czechoslovakia by peaceful means, but Hitler marched his troops into that country. In April 1939, Roosevelt again appealed to Hitler and Mussolini to prevent the disaster of war. Speaking from strength and human friendship, he asked these dictators not to invade 30 independent nations he named. He proposed negotiations to reduce the crushing economic burdens of armaments and to open international trade. Finally, 1 week before the war broke out, FDR sent an appeal to Hitler, King Victor Emmanuel of Italy, and President Mosicki of Poland, but only the Polish leader was interested in averting war. When war was declared, President Roosevelt sent messages to Britain, France, Italy, Germany, and Poland requesting that they not bomb civilians. In a fireside chat to the nation on September 3, 1939, he declared that the policy of the United States was neutrality. But he did not expect people to be neutral in their minds and consciences. He hoped that America would be able to stay out of the war. After winning an unprecedented third term as president at the end of 1940, Roosevelt declared that America must become the great arsenal of democracy to aid economically the Allies against the fascist warfare. Then he gave his famous Four Freedoms speech on January 6, 1941. America had been founded on the first two freedoms of religion and speech. Roosevelt's response to the Depression and World War II was to call for freedom from want and freedom from fear. Not only did he believe that all Americans deserved these rights, but also everyone in the world. Roosevelt said that freedom from want means economic understandings which will secure to every nation a healthy peacetime life for its inhabitants everywhere in the world. And freedom from fear means a worldwide reduction of armaments to such a point and in such a thorough fashion that no nation will be in a position to commit an act of physical aggression against any neighbor anywhere in the world. On March 11th, President Roosevelt signed the Lend-Lease Bill that allowed military and economic aid to the countries that were fighting Germany and Japan. In August 1941, Roosevelt and Winston Churchill, the Prime Minister for the United Kingdom, agreed on the Atlantic Charter, which declared their nation's principles and intentions in regard to the circumstances of the war. First, they sought no territorial aggrandizement. Second, they wanted no territorial changes that would not be in accord with the freely expressed wishes of the peoples concerned. Third, they respected the right of all peoples to self-government. Fourth, they supported states' equal access to trade and the raw materials of the world. Fifth, they wished to promote economic cooperation, improved labor standards, economic advancement, and social security. Sixth, after destroying the Nazi tyranny, they hoped to establish a peace that would be secure to all nations and peoples in freedom from fear and want. Seventh, this peace would include freedom of the seas. Eighth and last, they declared, all of the nations of the world, for realistic as well as spiritual reasons, must come to the abandonment of the use of force, since no future peace can be maintained if land, sea, or air armaments continue to be employed by nations which threaten or may threaten aggression outside of their frontiers. They believe, pending the establishment of a wider and permanent system of general security, that the disarmament of such nations is essential. They will likewise aid and encourage all other practicable measures which will lighten for peace-loving peoples the crushing burden of armaments. The they refers to the two signers, Franklin D. Roosevelt and Winston S. Churchill. With the surprise attack on the United States naval base at Pearl Harbor by the Japanese on December 7, 1941, America was drawn fully into the war. When Churchill and the Soviet ambassador Litvinov met with Roosevelt in Washington to confirm the new alliance against the Axis powers, FDR suggested the name United Nations. On January 1, 1942, these representatives, along with Sung of China, signed the Declaration of the United Nations to defend life, liberty, independence, and religious freedom, and to preserve human rights and justice in their own lands as well as in other lands. The pact was later signed by the other 22 nations named in the declaration. More than 3 years later, when the name of the new international organization was being discussed in San Francisco, the name United Nations was selected as a tribute to Roosevelt. Roosevelt conceived the organization as worldwide in scope, although important decisions would be made by the United States, Britain, Russia, and China, who would have the responsibility of policing the world. This is what he told the British Foreign Minister Anthony Eden and Churchill in March 1943. On November 1st, Secretary of State Cordell Hull, Eden, Soviet Foreign Minister Molotov, and the Chinese ambassador to Moscow signed the Moscow Declaration, in which the four powers agreed to maintain international peace after the war, stating that they recognized the necessity of establishing at the earliest practicable date a general international organization based on the principle of the sovereign equality of all peace-loving states and open to membership by all such states, large and small, for the maintenance of international peace and security. This statement was incorporated into the Connally Resolution and was passed by the United States Senate on November 6, 1943. Already, Congress was on record in favor of a world organization. On November 9th, representatives of 44 nations met at the White House and established the United Nations Relief and Rehabilitation Administration, UNRRA. At the end of November 1943, Roosevelt met with Churchill and Stalin at Tehran, and FDR began to share his outline of the Organization for the Preservation of World Peace. The assembly would include all members of the United Nations and would be worldwide in scope. They would discuss world problems and recommend solutions. The executive committee would be composed of the USSR, the US, the UK, and China, along with representatives of two European nations, one South American, one Middle Eastern, one Far Eastern, and one British Dominion. They would deal with all non-military questions such as economy, food, health, etc., but both Stalin and Roosevelt were reluctant to give them any binding power. The third group would be the four policemen, USSR, US, UK, and China. They would have the power to use force against any threat to the peace. Both Stalin and Churchill suggested regional committees, but Roosevelt did not expect the forces of China or the US to be needed in Europe. Apparently, the possibility of one of the four policemen being an aggressor was not discussed. The conference concluded amicably, with Roosevelt saying how nations with different customs and philosophies could blend in harmony like the colors of a rainbow for the common good. In his annual message to Congress in January 1944, Roosevelt proposed an economic bill of rights. He said that security means not only safety from attacks by aggressors, but also economic security, social security, moral security in a family of nations. He felt that these rights should include earning enough from a job for food, clothing, and recreation, buying and selling products, a decent home, medical care, and education. In August 1944, representatives of the Big Four met at the Dumbarton Oaks Conference in Washington. The Russians insisted that the Chinese be excluded until the major decisions were made by the other three powers. The tentative American plan had two broad purposes for the international organization. One, to preserve peace and security, and two, to promote international cooperation on economic and social problems. The plan now had five functional divisions. In addition to a General Assembly and Executive Council, there would be an International Court, a Secretariat, and subsidiary agencies. Security questions were to be solely vested in the Executive Council, which now would include France as a fifth permanent member and six rotating members. Any one of the five permanent members would be able to block an action in regard to disputes, settlements, sanctions, and uses of force. There was still a question whether one of the five powers could use this veto if that nation was itself involved in the dispute. The Americans went along with the British in proposing that a veto would not be allowed by a power who was a party to a dispute. The Soviet representative, Gromyko, responded to this by requesting that all 16 Soviet republics be included as charter members of the United Nations. Roosevelt felt that this would make it very difficult for him to get the international organization accepted by the United States Senate. With the abeyance of these two questions, the American tentative proposals were generally accepted. A compromise on the veto issue was suggested on September 13th and was later adopted in the United Nations Charter. A permanent member could veto any use of force, even if it was a party to a dispute, but it could not veto a decision which came under Pacific Settlement of Disputes if it was a party to that dispute. Roosevelt was elected to a fourth term as president, and in his inaugural address on January 20, 1945, he spoke of the lessons the United States had gained from the war. "We have learned that we cannot live alone at peace, that our own well-being is dependent on the well-being of other nations far away. We have learned that we must live as men, not as ostriches, nor as dogs in the manger. We have learned to be citizens of the world, members of the human community. We have learned the simple truth. Emerson said that the only way to have a friend is to be one. We can gain no lasting peace if we approach it with suspicion and mistrust and with fear. We can gain it only if we proceed with the understanding and confidence and courage which flow from conviction." Roosevelt met again with Churchill and Stalin at Yalta in February 1945. Stalin agreed to the veto solution but insisted on at least two extra votes for the Ukraine and Byelorussia in the General Assembly. Since it would not affect the Executive Council, and as a gesture of goodwill toward the Russians, who had lost 20 million killed fighting the Nazis, Roosevelt accepted this proposal if the UN conference they scheduled to begin in San Francisco on April 25th would also accept the two additional Russian republics after discussion and a free vote. Roosevelt considered the Crimean Conference more successful than the peace efforts made a quarter of a century earlier. He believed that a universal organization of all peace-loving nations should mark the end of methods such as unilateral action, exclusive alliances, spheres of influence, and balances of power which had failed for centuries. On March 1st, President Roosevelt reported to the Congress about the Crimean Conference, saying how the Senate was being advised of the new International Security Organization and declaring world peace is not a party question. World peace cannot depend upon the work of one man, one party, or one nation, or even the large nations or the small nations. It must be a peace which rests on the cooperative effort of the whole world. In a press conference on April 5th, Roosevelt expressed the view that for the Soviet Union to have 3 votes in the General Assembly was not that significant because it was only an investigative body that really would not decide important issues. Franklin Roosevelt died on April 12, 1945. On that day, he wrote a speech to be given in honor of Thomas Jefferson's birthday the next day. He looked past the conquest of the malignant Nazi state toward the conquest of the root causes, doubts, fears, ignorance, and greed. He asked us to face the fact that, if civilization is to survive, we must cultivate the science of human relationships, the ability of all peoples of all kinds to live together and work together in the same world, at peace. The work, my friends, is peace, more than an end to this war. An end to the beginning of all wars, yes, an end forever to this impractical, unrealistic settlement of the differences between governments by the mass killing of peoples. In his last words, he appealed to people to dedicate themselves to peace and act with faith. The only limit to our realization of tomorrow will be our doubts of today. Let us move forward with strong and active faith. United Nations Charter. We, the peoples of the United Nations, determined to save succeeding generations from the scourge of war, which twice in our lifetime has brought untold sorrow to mankind, and to reaffirm faith in fundamental human rights, in the dignity and worth of the human person, in the equal rights of men and women, and of nations large and small, and to establish conditions under which justice and respect for the obligations arising from treaties and other sources of international law can be maintained, and to promote social progress and better standards of life in larger freedom, and for these ends to practice tolerance and live together in peace with one another as good neighbors, and to unite our strength to maintain international peace and security, and to ensure by the acceptance of principles and the institution of methods that armed force shall not be used save in the common interest, and to employ international machinery for the promotion of the economic and social advancements of all peoples, have resolved to combine our efforts to accomplish these aims. Charter of the United Nations. Delegates of 50 nations met in San Francisco on April 25th for the United Nations Conference on International Organization. Using the Dumbarton Oaks proposals as a basis, they worked in committees and plenary sessions to draw up the 111 Article Charter, which was adopted unanimously on June 25, 1945. The Charter became effective the following October 24th after China, France, the Soviet Union, the United Kingdom, the United States, and a majority of the signing nations had ratified the document. The first article of the United Nations Charter reads as follows. The purposes of the United Nations are: 1. To maintain international peace and security, and to that end, to take effective collective measures for the prevention and removal of threats to peace, and for the suppression of acts of aggression or other breaches of the peace, and to bring about by peaceful means and in conformity with the principles of justice and international law, adjustment or settlement of international disputes, or situations which might lead to a breach of the peace. 2. To develop friendly relations among nations based on respect for the principle of equal rights and self-determination of peoples, and to take other appropriate measures to strengthen universal peace. 3. To achieve international cooperation in solving international problems of an economic, social, cultural, or humanitarian character, and in promoting and encouraging respect for human rights and for fundamental freedoms for all, without distinction as to race, sex, language, or religion, and 4, to be a center for harmonizing the actions of nations in the attainment of these common ends. In the second article, the members agree to act in accordance with the following principles. 1. The sovereign equality of all members. 2. Fulfillment of charter obligations. 3. Settlement of international disputes by peaceful means in such a manner that international peace and security and justice are not endangered. 4. Refraining from the threat or use of force against the territorial integrity of or political independence of any state. 5. Assistance of the United Nations and refraining from assisting any state against which the United Nations is taking preventive or enforcement action. 6. Ensuring that states that are not members act in accordance with the principles. And 7. The United Nations is not authorized to intervene within the domestic jurisdiction of any state. The second chapter describes membership. The third chapter lists the organs as a General Assembly, a Security Council, an Economic and Social Council, a Trusteeship Council, an International Court of Justice, and a Secretariat. The fourth chapter describes the General Assembly in which each member shall have one vote. The fifth chapter defines the Security Council, naming China, France, the Soviet Union, the United Kingdom, and the United States as permanent members. Article 26 begins, "In order to promote the establishment and maintenance of international peace and security with the least diversion for armaments of the world's human and economic resources," and it sets up a committee to work to establish a system for the regulation of armaments. Chapter 6, entitled Pacific Settlement of Disputes, begins with Article 33. The parties to any dispute, the continuance of which is likely to endanger the maintenance of international peace and security, shall first of all seek a solution by negotiation, inquiry, mediation, conciliation, arbitration, judicial settlement, resort to regional agencies or arrangements, or other peaceful means of their own choice. The Security Council may request parties to use such means, may investigate disputes, and may make recommendations. Chapter 7 discusses actions which may be taken to maintain or restore international peace when there are threats to the peace, breaches of the peace, and acts of aggression. The Security Council may decide to use force or economic sanctions and call upon member nations to make available armed forces, assistance, and facilities. Chapter 8 states that regional arrangements for maintaining peace are not precluded by the Charter. When Harry Truman became president and the atomic bomb was developed, the relations of the United States toward the Soviet Union and the United Nations began to change into the Cold War. Lend-lease aid to Russia was ended on May 12, 1945, while Britain was granted a low-interest loan. Soviet fears of an international bloc against them were also fed by American support for regional blocs' use of collective self-defense, which reversed the U.S. position at Dumbarton Oaks. Truman also decided to use the atomic bomb as a bargaining factor in dealing with the Russians, and he attempted to negate Roosevelt's abandonment of control over Eastern Europe. In October 1945, Truman saw the UN as the only alternative to a bitter armament race with the Russians.